pfSense packages and a pfSense package manager. So the package manager is pretty cool, and it allows you to, you know, add a lot of add-ons for pfSense. And I like this feature quite a bit. But of course, once you get a bunch of packages in a list, you immediately go to the question, okay, I see all these fun things in here. Which one should I load? What should I be loading here in pfSense? What works? So I'm going to make a short list of the ones I usually load for people and talk about why I load them and, you know, ones I find useful. There's more in there. Maybe you have more use cases for those than I do, but these are the basics here. I am going to skip NTOP PNG and skip Sericata and Snort. I have separate videos on those, and I generally do load like Sericata on a system if someone's going to be taking the time to manage that system and make sure those alerts are addressed in there. So if not, loading Sericata just gives you a good feeling, but no extra protection if you're not going to manage the alerts and spend time fine-tuning it. But these are the basic ones outside of that. And as well as the same with NTOP PNG, it's very resource intensive, and I don't find it to be that amazing, so to speak. It's kind of cool when you're doing a diagnostic and trying to dig in some stuff, but leaving it running all the time just kind of taxes the system, generally unnecessarily. And if it's not a more powerful pfSense, it can also just suck up a lot of CPU time and log time and potentially create other issues if you don't have a fast system. So basic packages that I have installed in most systems. This is our demo system we have here. We're going to start with ARPWatch. And ARPWatch is a pretty neat little tool. Now, ARPWatch is going to rely on the fact that you have email set up, and it's under System, Advanced, and Last tab allows you to set up notifications. You can set a SMTP server up so pfSense can notify you via email if there's any changes. Now, ARPWatch specifically watches a network. And perhaps if you wanted had a lockdown network for your servers where there's no changes going on, well, ARPWatch is great for that because you can say, all right, I'm going to point it at that particular network, and if anything happens on the network, if there's any change, someone plugged another server into a switch or something like that, it immediately notifies you if a MAC address changes, if there's something going on in your server-side network. So obviously you don't want this on your LAN-side network because you have computers shutting off, turning on, they come and go, new, you know, devices, your phone comes on the network, your phone goes off that network. Those are going to create noise, and then it becomes very useless. But when you talk about a lockdown security side of the network that is a separate place where your servers live, you want to know if there's any change to that network, and ARPWatch is a really simple way to do that. So I really only load this if the client has a separate network that needs to be monitored. If they don't, or if everything's like a more flat network or smaller office where that's just not necessary, or you don't want the network server on another segment, okay, I don't always use it. But it's a cool one there if you want to watch a specific segment of a network for changes. You can even put this on an insecure network because you can monitor each one. It's basically anytime you want a network and you just want to be notified anytime there's a change and have it send an email to you. But like I said, it's a time waster if you stick it on a network that has devices coming and going. Next one down, Darkstat. Darkstat's pretty cool. It, first warning, it if you set up Darkstat, and we'll show you where it's set up at, you go here to Diagnostics, Darkstat Settings, which is where we're at now, it binds to port 666 by default. Now, because I'm accessing this in the lab, I've tied it both to my LAN and WAN address, but there's no security on Darkstat. It just works. So it's a read-only. It's not like you're manipulating any data. But by the way, whatever address you bound it to, create your own rules if you need to, but it's going to allow anyone to view that statistics and data in there. So it gives you this cool real-time graph to show you the data. Then you can click on any host and see the hosts that are connected. Here's my computer connected to this lab machine. And you can see the connections and accumulations on there. But it's nice when you're just looking for where's all the data going and trying to sort that out. So it's a really basic kind of blunt tool, but it's kind of cool because it gives little graphs and it does look pretty neat. And, you know, get an idea of where some of these requests are going to and what computers are making those requests. And like I said, it's a basic tool, but it gives you an idea of where to start looking. My go-to is going to Diagnostics and PFTOP, the built-in PFTOP, to dig into connections and see where they're actually going and what's actually touching what on here. For example, we'll pull this up. 192.168.3.9. We go to host. This will give me much more in depth, but host Darkstat can be that first point of, okay, first, why is this particular IP address pulling a lot of data? And you can sort how much data is being pulled by IP address on there. So like I said, it's a handy little utility and doesn't tax the system very much having it on there. IPERF is for benchmarking. We're going to go over here to diagnostics, iPerf client, and then under that is iPerf server. And iPerf allows you to create either TCP, UDP sessions between other boxes. You can download iPerf directly, load it on a multitude of different things from your phone to your Linux box to your Windows box. And then, unfortunately, this is iPerf version 1, not iPerf 3, the current version. I'm not sure why they package an older version. I'm guessing it's a BSD thing just to have the old version on there, not the new one. But it does allow quick, easy ways to determine speed between two devices and make sure that you can see that, you know, how much speed you can get across. And maybe you have two pfSense boxes. You can expose iPerf to the internet. Don't leave it exposed. Maybe create a temporary rule. And you want to connect to your other pfSense box and see what kind of traversal they have for speed or internal boxes to see if they can connect to it very fast. So it's handy. I do like it when I've got to do a little bit of that testing and make sure the pfSense can talk to something at a reasonable speed. And it doesn't have to run as a service, so it's not something that's running all the time. You can start and stop it as a service, so it's not really taking up anything on the pfSense to leave it on there. Nmap. Now, while Nmap is available, I never really use it inside of here because it just doesn't expose all the features. This is more of a login and run it as a command line. So you log into that pfSense box, type nmap, and it's your standard, all the details from using nmap from the command line. And this is really nice when you want to scan a client's network looking for things if they have a pfSense at the head end, because nmap now sits at the pivotal point of the network if they have several different VLANs, several different LANs set up, because this has access and has feet in all of them. One box, I can scan all the separate networks through here, create a series of files. I just dump them all out to an exportable file, copy them back off, and bring them over to the local machine to do more analysis on them. Like I said, my preference is to run it right from the command line and get all the information I need with whatever parameters I want for that network scan. But it does open it up within the UI here, so you can do a little bit of scanning on devices and get some information about them. And this is what it looks like when you run the scan on a local one. So you can see what's open, what it can see, and what it can get at when it's on this right here. Next on the list, OpenVPN Client Export. Obviously, I only load this if they're even using OpenVPN, but this is a great utility to make it really easy to export VPN settings. And of course, you find that under VPN. We'll go here, go back. Then under Client Export, and it builds an automatic export. I've done this in my OpenVPN videos with some customizations, so you can choose the server, choose the details about the server, and export easily the OpenVPN config. Now, this is a common I load on the majority of the time, pretty much everyone's systems, is pfBlockerng, because pfBlocker is awesome. And I've done a video on this specifically about how to configure it. There's two sides to pfBlocker. There's the external blocking that is great if they have ports open. If they don't have ports open, I don't worry about that as much. And then there is the outbound blocking and the sinkholing that you can do on some of the databases to say, all right, they don't need to go to these sites and put in risk sites to just black hole those, you know, and some people use it for ads and it works for that as well. So sinkholing bad sites, ad sites, and things like that. And it's all doing it via DNS. So it's not exactly like a web filter, but sinkholing via DNS, quite a few different crappy or bad or ad sites is always great. The last one I load is status traffic totals. I'm going to drag over my firewall to show you what that looks like once it's loaded up. So status traffic totals is under the status menu, and it gives you these cool little graphs that you can go hourly, daily, or even monthly and see how much data per month was pushed out across each of the networks on there, in and out. So it's definitely a kind of novel way to do this. It gathers all the statistics. It has options if we display advanced here. Export as a CSV. One note is when you set this up, when you first load it, you just have to click enable graphing because by default it doesn't graph anything. So if you load this and assume it just works, it doesn't. But it's not too intensive on the machine. It just gathers up statistics and puts this pretty basic graph together for all of it. But it also is handy because of the CSV export that it has. So if you ever want to do some further longer term analysis, and this can be helpful for bandwidth, if you want to make sure you are capacity playing enough, you can look at how much over time each of your networks and each of your network segments is using. So this is, you know, handy little utility for doing that. And especially if you want to know things like just how much VPN is being used, you can select like this right here. I'll hit save as default. I'm going to add in that VPN as well. And I can now add in how much the two VPNs that we have set up on our network are using. So handy little utility. And it's like this right under here under traffic totals. And it's a little bit more in depth because it's keeping cumulative over time. And pfSense doesn't have a lot of that out of the box by default. You're cumulative over time until you load the traffic status totals. So hopefully this was helpful. Like I said, there's not a long list of things that I install in here. It's just a handful of them. This is my pfSense, my server. So I do have Cirrucata and Zabbix on here because I use Zabbix for monitoring. So I do have those in here as well. And like I said, that comes back to Yuke's case. If you're using Nagios for monitoring, that is also built into pfSense because it has that an option. But you even, as I mentioned, can see like NTOP PNG over here. I don't have it set up or in use as a constantly running even on my server, which is a reasonably fast server. It's a Xeon at 3 gigahertz, 4-core system. So hopefully this helps and gets you started with pfSense. Like I said, feel free to play with all the packages. They're free. They're not no charge to anything that you want to add on, and maybe you'll find some other ones that are useful. I do recommend, because people have asked me about loading like third-party packages, I go with what is recommended and known to work based on the people, the development team at pfSense, because if a package is really good and really popular, it can be properly submitted to the to be officially supported. But you can get some unpredictable results if you run things unpredictably on your firewall, which, because this is at the edge of the network and supposed to be protecting it, I highly recommend not loading random things on there unless it's for experimentation or for your lab or for some testing, but not in a production environment, so at least not in any of mine do I run any one-off third-party packages unless I'm super confident. And I can't think of any time I've done that recently. Might be fun to play with a few things and load them on there. But for the most part, yeah, I stick with what they support, because then it becomes part of the regular updates that they have in there. All right, thanks. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. If you want to subscribe to this channel to see more content, hit that subscribe button and the bell icon, and maybe YouTube will send you a notice when we post. If you want to hire us for a project that you've seen or discussed in this video, head over to lawrencesystems.com, where we offer both business IT services and consulting services, and are excited to help you with whatever project you want to throw at us. Also, if you want to carry on the discussion further, head over to forums.lawrencesystems.com, where we can keep the conversation going. And if you want to help the channel out in other ways, we offer affiliate links below, which offer discounts for you and a small cut for us that does help fund this channel. And once again, thanks again for watching this video, and see you on next time.